home-preserved foods, although my mother would have said that as well. Indeed, rest her soul, yeah. She would have.
There are a couple of funny, you see, I also said to you, this book is full of funny stories. So even if you're not a writer, it's a book to read before you give it to your grandchild who wants to be a screenwriter.
Well, that's a wonderful compliment. Thank you.
You are welcome. Including, I had to say to you, are you still married?
Still married. I recently agreed with my wife that we're going to try this for 43 more years, and if it still hasn't worked out, then that's enough already.
But the reason I ask it is you talk about a dinner party where you talk about screenwriting, and she says, no, that's not at all what it should be. And you say, finally, look, all writers fantasize.
Right. The the truth squad follows me around. I have the truth squad right there in my house, and sometimes I think this is probably an occupational hazard for writers, for creators of fictional narratives, mm-hmm. that we sometimes embellish, tell things better than they really happened. Yeah. And sometimes I am called back to reality. And she will explain to me, but this is not a pitch at a movie studio. This is just dinner with friends. I'm not sure she's wrong about that.
Now we get to, for the neophyte, how do I get an agent? And you say, write a query letter.
Yes. So, well, of course, first write a great script that's worthy of an agent. Yeah. So many people put the cart before the horse. Well, what if you get to an agent and the material isn't particularly good? It's most important, first of all, to truly be confident that your script is ready. The biggest mistake writers make is we write too much. Scripts are too long, scenes are too long, too much description, too much dialogue, movies are too long. The next mistake we make is we show our scripts before they're really ready. Mm-hmm. And see, the first thing is you want to be ready. And then a smart query letter, an old-fashioned query letter, and I actually think it's better for it to be an analog, ink on paper, hard copy letter.
Yeah.
Rather than email, because it will stand out.
Delete if it's the email.
Yes, too easy to delete. Yeah. And also, it's so unusual that anybody actually writes a paper letter now that it kind of makes it stand out and calls attention. Then the trick is to keep that letter short. One quick, sexy, engaging sentence about the writer, just one.
Yeah.
And then just one, maybe two, but not more, sentences about the project that are engaging, again, that don't fill you in but leave out a lot and make you curious to know what the script is about.
Now we get to the successful writer who says, I got a call from George Lucas. That story is enough to make one say, you've got to be kidding. When he doesn't want to pay you or have the producer pay you for the second version of your writing?
Well, you're referring to my own work on American Graffiti, which I do talk about in the book, kind of as a memoirish kind of case study. The first thing I have to say is I was paid, fully paid, and all of my contract was observed. And
but not without a fight.
Well, the thing is that George, the deal was made for, and it was pretty typical in those days, for what they call a draft, and sometimes they call it a set. This was a draft, I think, and a polish. And he decided he really wanted to, he would have to write the script himself after he saw the first draft, and wanted out of the polish. And I felt that the contract ought to be observed. There really wasn't and isn't any controversy about it. He doesn't tell it any differently. And I have to say he's complimented me from time to time in interviews he's given regarding the professional level of the work that I did. It was just too, and there's nothing unusual about there being a lot of writers on a screenplay and not all of them getting credit. Indeed,
but if you don't get the credit, and I know this from the director's point of view, you are not going to get that residual.
Well, it's true. It depends on the deal. But yes, if you don't get credit, you're
on
going to have
screen.
A reduced on screen. It will affect the payment and other aspects of the deal. But as I say, I was well paid for what I did, and It actually led me to, for a number of years, to be the go-to guy for adolescent coming-of-age stories. I wrote Loss of Innocence tales, Rite of Passage stories for pretty much all of the studios after that. Most of the movies didn't get made. They were constantly changing hands, the studios. A lot of flux, a lot of traffic among the executive boards. And that's not really good news for producers and for writers. But still, I was well paid and did creative work for major studios and enjoyed myself enormously.
For the young writer coming out of your school, you say he or she should really go to the studio and see that room with all of the bought but unmade screenplays.
Yes, yes. I like to recommend to writers that when they register their screenplay, that is to say, the Writers Guild has a service whereby you can register the script with them so that you are protected should there ever be any question that arises as to whether or not somebody purloined your material later. There'll be a record of it. And you can do that now online. But I always urge writers to go to the registration office at the Writers Guild on 3rd Street, and because they will see how many people are there and how much material is there that is being registered. And it will remind them how important it is, I hope it will remind them, to stand out, to make sure. And the way to stand out is to have the script really, really be good. And again, good means integrated. Everything that happens moves that story forward, and that's how you bring a reader along through the length and breadth of that narrative.
Yeah, I mean, because even then you say in the book in the beginning, in that script, every scene should almost be Aristotelian of beginning, middle, and end.